कैसे करें, हर पल सोचे हम शुक्रिया कैसे कहें, या मौला शाह करीम हमारे मौला, कैसे करेंगे हम तेरा शुक्रिया।
Shining on people of love and peace when anger and hate decreased. Only to open my eyes to a dark sky. We ain't living right, old dreams fight. When all we gotta give is a hand and a smile to move far from this inch to a mile. But instead, we keep wrapping ourselves in chains. When we gonna change? Abstain from violence and work together to prevent the pain. And realize that we're all the same. If we work together, then we have the world to gain.
In the air, we all need a prayer. We need each other. So stop with all the pain, put aside the hate. We are all the same.
If we want to change the world, we gotta make a team to see what it needs.
Thank you. of the road. I'm on my
me. Oh, oh, oh. difference could I make? One act of kindness cannot undo the world's mistakes. We're of the people with faith, nothing divine can come to be without a spark, and we will
अगर रुक जाए हम कहीं इस पल को यूं ही थाम लो ख्वाब को देख कर सितारों को छूने हम वादियों में घूमते को जाए कहीं फिर से हम ख्वाब को देख कर सितारों को छू ले हम वादियों में घूमते खो जाए कहीं फिर से हम दरख्तों की छांव में बैठे रहे शाम तक इन बारिशों की बूंद में भीग जाएंगे हम सुनो जरा फिर से सुनो ओ रुको मेरे पास रुको सहम जाऊं मैं कहीं मुझको फिर से तुम थाम लो चल रहे मेरे साथ रहना यूं ही खो भी जाए तो क्या हुआ अब कोई भी गम नहीं भीड़ में चल रहे मेरे साथ रहना यूं ही खो भी जाए तो क्या हुआ अब कोई भी गम नहीं बेख्याली में भी साथ चलते रहे हर कदम इन यादों में भी अब दूर ना होंगे हम करो मेरा एतबार करो ओ पंछियों की तरह मेरे साथ उड़ चलो दरीचे हैं सामने रोशनी को भी तुम थाम लो सपनों में ओ कहो अब कैरी दो जो सुनना मैं चाहूं इन आंखों से भी तुम कहो तुम सुनो
choose hope. I've come this far, I wanna see. empty lies. What happens in the darkness when fear and pain collide? Find the guiding light, stand for all who can't fight. Yes, we can break boundaries. No one won't stay silent. Feel the change I wanna see. Gotta ignite it.
Today, the hospital employs some of the most qualified and competent human resources, supplemented by world-class technical expertise, and that this hospital will offer specialized programs in cardiology, oncology, neurosciences, advanced critical care, diagnostics, as well as responding to the increasing burden of non-communicable diseases in Tanzania. These services come in addition to our traditional key focus areas of maternal, neonatal, and child health, which have also been strengthened as a result of this expansion, the Phase 2 building. I'm delighted that this advanced facility will allow all Tanzanians to receive world-class treatment at home, and therefore reversing the need for medical tourism abroad, and hopefully encouraging medical tourism within the region.
یا علی مدد، خوش آمدید و سال نو مبارک. با تشکر از همراهی شما در یکی دیگر از بازتاب‌های جمعه شب. اسم من صفیقه کارا است و مفتخر هستم که از همه اعضای جماعتی، اعضای خانواده های آنان با باورهای مختلف عقیدتی و همه کسانی که از سراسر جهان ما را می‌بینند و می‌شنوند، پذیرایی می‌کنم. من از کالگری با شما می پیوندم و جایی بسا افتخار است که میزبان برنامه امشب می باشم. چند هفته اخیر برای من و بسیاری از همکارانم هیجان انگیز بوده است و همچنین من فکر می کنم همه ما با داشتن امید به آینده بهتر نفس راحت می کشیم. من و بسیاری از اعضای تیم خط مقدم ما اولین دوز یا مقدار واکسین کووید 19 را دریافت کردیم. ما سپاسگزار هستیم که اولین گام های من را برای محافظت از کسانی که از آنها مراقبت می کنیم برداشته ایم و اکنون بهتر می توانیم به همه کسانی که نیازمند هستند کمک کنیم. به عنوان یک ارائه دهنده خدمت در خط مقدم در پروژه مسکن نسل های انجمن ما در کالگری، من همچنان بسیار خرسندم و با آگاهیتان می رسانم که باشندگان این پروژه اولین مقدار واکسین کووید 19 را در روز 13 جنوری 2021 دریافت کردند. ای کاش همه شما می توانستید در آن روز با ما باشید. روز خاطر انگیزی بود. وقتی که ما وارد ساختمان شدیم، ساکنان عمارت با هیجان منتظر بودند و توانستیم هر یک از ساکنین را واکسین کنیم. ما را در هر اتاق با یک لبخند و سپس کمی گریه استقبال کردند و در نهایت ابراز سپاس نمودند. ساکنان این ساختمان به مدت 9 ماه از خانواده و عزیزان خود جدا افتاده بودند. 13 جنوری روزی بود که آنها شروع به دیدن نور در انتهای دهلیز کووید 19 کردند. من بسیار احساس خوشبختی می کنم که همه ساکنان این ساختمان ما اولین مقدار واکسین را دریافت کردند. با این واکسین نه تنها از خودمان محافظت می کنیم بلکه از یک دیگر نیز محافظت می کنیم. همانطور که تیم ما و ساکنان اینجا اولین دوز واکسین را دریافت کردند، ما مشتاقانه منتظر دوز یا مقدار دوم واکسین خود در اواسط ماه فوریه هستیم. بر اساس مطالعات انجام شده، همه ما می توانیم احساس امنیت کامل نماییم چون که واکسین با 95% اثربخشی در جریان 3 هفته بعد از دوز دوم مایه امیدواری را فراهم می سازد. همانطور که می دانید بیماری های مرتبط با کووید 19 برای خانه های سالمندان با مراقبت طولانی مدت زیادی در سراسر کشور و ایرانگری کرد و فاجعه آفرید. و من خیلی خوشحالم که توانستیم از بعضی از آسیب پذیرترین اعضای جماعت محافظت کنیم. اگر خیلی مشتاق هستید بدانید دریافت واکسین در بازو چگونه است، باید برایتان بگویم که خیلی آسان و بدون احساس درد. خودم شخصا هیچ عوارض جانبی را تجربه نکردم به جز از یک حس سنگینی خفیف در بازو و یک چسب روی جای سوزن. با عنوان یادآوری، انشاءالله همه ما شانس دریافت واکسین را به زودی خواهیم داشت. و حالا بیایید نگاهی به برنامه امشب بیاندازیم. تمرکز ما روی پاسخ خدمات بورد صحی آقاخان در رابطه با بیماری همگیر است. به عنوان فردی که در تاجکستان با بنیاد انکشافی آقاخان کار کرده است، من می توانم از کار بورد صحی آقاخان و برخی از چالش های بهداشتی که در سایر زمینه ها با آن مواجه هستند قدردانی کنم. من در کار با بورد صحی آقاخان و تاجکستان تجربیات دست اول در رابطه با رویکرد چند وجهی که توسط بنیاد انکشافی آقاخان برای تقویت سیستم های مراقبت صحی گرفته شده بود را کسب کردم. این رویکردها شامل آموزش، تمرینات حمایتی برای ارائه دهندگان صحت در محلات، به شمول پرستاران، دکتران، تکنیسین های آزمایشگاه و همچنین ارتقای سلامت جامعه، برنامه های واکسیناسیون، کلینیک های اولیه صحی، کلینیک های دندان، بیمارستان ها و مراکز تشخیصی می باشد. بنیاد انکشافی آقاخان و بورد صحی آقاخان همراه با دولت های محلی توانستند با وجود شرایط منزوی و کوهستانی دسترسی و خدمات صحی با کیفیت را به همه بهبود بخشند. ما برنامه امشب را با سخنانی از رئیس انجمن ملی کانادا امیر علی قاسم لاکا در رابطه با بخش دوم برنامه‌های از قلب آغاز خواهیم کرد که وی در رابطه سخنانش درباره داشتن مهارت‌های نرم مورد نیاز برای موفقیت در دنیای امروز صحبت می‌کند. لطفاً به رئیس امیر خوش آمد بگویید.
مدیابران سیسترز یالی مدد.
برادران و خواهران عزیزم یالی مدد. امشب دومین جلسه بحث در مجموعه از قلب است. ما هر هفته در مورد یک ویژگی خاص برای موفقیت در دنیای امروز اشاره می کنیم. هفته گذشته درباره فعالیت‌های سازمانی و تمایلمان برای پذیرش تغییر و کنترل امور زندگی صحبت کردیم. در بحث دوم ما می خواهم در مورد اهمیت داشتن یک دیدگاه، تعیین اهداف درست و برنامه‌ریزی هایی که باید برای تحقق بخشیدن آنها انجام دهیم صحبت کنم. اجازه دهید ابتدا با توضیح اهمیت آرزو داشتن برای آینده شروع کنم. ما اهداف بلند مدت را تعیین می کنیم زیرا آنها به زندگی ما معنی می بخشند. این اهداف به ما خاطر نشان می کنند که چگونه تلاش های خود را متمرکز کنیم، تصمیم گیری نماییم و زمان خود را درک کنیم. زندگی طولانی است و پر از شگفتی ها. آرزوهای ما مانند ستاره قطب است که به ما حس جهتیابی می بخشد تا در سفر خود گم نشویم. بی‌توجهی به آینده بسیار آسان است، زیرا ما مصروف کارهای زندگی و مشکلات زندگی روزمره هستیم. برای ایجاد و توسعه یک دیدگاه ما باید خود و فرزندان خود را و نسل‌های آینده خود را در یک برهه زمانی 10، 20، 50 سال مشاهده کنیم و همه ابعادی را که به زندگی ما معنی می‌بخشد در نظر بگیریم. خانواده، دوستی‌ها، تجارت، دین و جامعه، زیرا هر یک از اینها مهم هستند. موفقیت در هر یک از اینها برای ما به چه معناست؟ اگر ما در تجسم آینده خود مشکل داریم و یا نیاز به انگیزه داریم، می توانیم از نمونه های اطراف خود استفاده کنیم. می توانیم به دوستان، مربیان و سایر افراد موفق مراجعه کنیم. زندگی آنها را و قدم هایی که آنها برای موفقیت برداشتند تحلیل و ارزیابی کنیم. برای این کار ما می توانیم قطعاتی از ابعادی که زندگی ما را شکل می دهد کنار هم قرار دهیم. تعیین اهداف تلاش بسیار عالی و جدی است. این داستان است که فرزندان ما و نوه‌های ما درباره ما خواهند آموخت. پیامدهایی که فراتر از زمان ما باقی خواهد ماند. پس دیدگاه ما باید بلند پروازانه باشد و هرگاه به اهداف خود فکر می‌کنیم باید خود را تحت فشار قرار دهیم تا بالاتر و بالاتر فکر کنیم. به بالاترین آرزوها فکر کنید. آرزوهایی که عملی کردن آنها خیلی سخت است. نمی گویم دور از واقعیت باشید، اما ما در مورد هدف زندگی خود صحبت می کنیم و باید دیدگاه ما را عالی ترسیم کنیم. ما باید مثبت باشیم، تصویر مثبتی ایجاد کنیم که بتوانیم در جهت آن تلاش کنیم. پس چگونه می توانیم آرزوهای بلند مدت خود را تحقق بخشیم؟ ما می توانیم بزرگترین آرزوها را داشته باشیم، اما این اهداف را چگونه برآورده کنیم؟ می توانیم با دید وسیع‌تر شروع کنیم و به طور سیستماتیک و قدم به قدم گذشته را مرور کنیم. برای این کار ما می توانیم یک برنامه‌ای که عملی شود، تصمیمات و پیوندهای بین شرایط فعلی و نتیجه نهایی خود ایجاد کنیم. در بسیاری موارد آسان نیست که از الف تا یا برسیم. در عوض ما باید تلاش بیشتر کنیم و بر روی یک اصل پایه‌گذاری نماییم. در مسیر این برنامه ریزی ما می توانیم از تجارب دیگران که در این راه قدم برداشتند استفاده کنیم. کسانی که در همین راه از ما پیشتر بودند، آنها در همین مسیر قبلا قدم گذاشتند. از خرد و رهنمایی آنها استفاده کنیم، زیرا این کار مسیر ما را سرعت می بخشد. تصورات اشتباه ذهن ما را اصلاح می کند و مطمئن می شویم که اشتباهاتی که آنها کرده اند ما مرتکب نشویم. به همین خاطر است که مربیان و افراد موفق اهمیت دارند و دلیل ما برای ایجاد پروگرام آموزشی سریع هم همین بود. به خاطر داشته باشید که تحقق اهداف ما به زمان نیاز دارد. احتمالاً به دیگران که موفقیت بزرگ به دست آوردن نگاه کنیم و از خود بپرسیم که ما چگونه می توانیم به آن موفقیت برسیم. موفقیت در طول زمان ساخته می شود و یک شبه به وجود نمی آید. نتیجه ای که ما در دیگران مشاهده می کنیم نمونه کوچکی از سخت کوشی ها، مربیگری، عقب نشینی ها، پشت کار، فعالیت‌های سازمانی و برنامه‌ریزی هاست. اجازه دهید یک مثال بزنم. فرض کنید برای پذیرش در یک مؤسسه عالی آموزشی تلاش می‌کنیم. پذیرش در رشته‌های تحصیلی برتر بدون سال‌ها آینده‌نگری و آمادگی امکان پذیر نیست. اگر با فرصت کافی خود را برای لحظه‌ای که باید درخواست کنیم آماده نسازیم، پنجره فرصت بر روی ما بسته خواهد شد، با اینکه از نظر عقلانی قوی و دارای شایستگی های ذاتی باشیم. وقتی کسی موفق است، ما نمونه کوچکی از سخت‌کوشی او را مشاهده می کنیم و درک می کنیم که چقدر برای رسیدن به این موفقیت تلاش کرده است. بنابراین من جوانان من را تشویق می کنم که به دقت در مورد زندگی روزمره فکر کنند و اینکه آیا ما بر زندگی خود کنترل داریم و آیا با دقت برای تحقق آرزوهای خود برنامه ریزی کرده ایم. انگامی که به ارزشمندترین سرمایه های خود فکر می کنیم، غالبا به داشته های خود می اندیشیم و با احتیاط فوق‌العاده از آن مواظبت می کنیم. اما ما در مورد گرانبهاترین سرمایه خود که زمان است به ندرت فکر می کنیم. ما از زمان خود طوری استفاده می کنیم که گویا بی پایان است و وقت خود را به جای مصرف می کنیم که باعث پیشرفت نمی شود. آرزوهای درازمدت ما باید در موفقیت زندگی روزمره ما نقش داشته باشند. آرزوها و عملکردهای ما باید در یک مسیر قرار گیرند. آنها باید به هم پیوند داشته باشند. در غیر آن صورت ما نمی توانیم به آرزوهای من برسیم. بنابراین من به جوانان من می گویم هر روز یک رویکرد ساختاری و روشمند داشته باشید. وقت خود را سامان دهید. در مورد اهداف خود فکر کنید. برای یک فرصت بی نظیر آماده شوید یا یک رابطه خاص را برقرار کنید. با استفاده خوب از وقتتان مطمئن شوید که اولویت ها را در نظر گرفته اید. با کنترل کردن دقیقه خود می توانید ساعت ها، روزها، ماه ها و سپس سال های خود را کنترل کنید. برادران و خواهران عزیزم، در کنار هدیه زندگی که به ما اعطا شده است، به ما فرصت هم داده شده است تا در جهت رسیدن به سرنوشت متعالی تلاش کنیم. امام محبوبمان ما را برای تعیین اهداف بلند پروازانه رهنمایی کرده است. به یاد داشته باشیم که زمان زندگی ما در دنیا محدود است. پس با هدف و در بالاترین سطح توانایی خود عمل کنیم. منظور از بحث امشب فراهم کردن ساختاری بود برای انجام این کار و عمیق فکر کردن درباره زندگی که می‌خواهیم بسازیم تا بتوانیم آرزوهای خود را به واقعیت تبدیل کنیم. از توجه شما تشکر و خدا حافظ.
از شما بسیار سپاسگزارم رئیس صاحب، از اینکه افکارتان را با ما شریک ساختید. امشب ما افتخار داریم که دکتر گیج سوال ریون، مدیر بخش صحی بنیاد انکشافی آقاخان را با خود داریم. خیلی خوش شانس بودم که هفته پیش با وی صحبتی داشتم. ما با یک ویدیوی کوتاه که فعالیت برد صحی آقاخان در طول بیماری همگیر را شرح می دهد شروع می کنیم که روایتگر آن شخص دکتر وال ریون می باشد. و با دنبال آن بحث های شگفت‌انگیز قبلی من با وی را خواهید دید. همانطوری که اشاره کردم، دکتر گیجز وال ریون مدیر بخش صحی در بنیاد انکشافی آقاخان یا AKDN است که در ژنو مستقر می باشد. دکتر وال ریون همچنین استاد افتخاری علوم در بخش سلامت جامعه در دانشگاه آقاخان است. دکتر وال ریون در سال 2003 به بنیاد انکشافی آقاخان پیوست. قبل از آن، ایشان برای یک دوره 15 ساله در آفریقا در زمینه ارائه مراقبت‌های بهداشتی، مدیریت و تحقیقات با تمرکز عمده بر سیستم‌های صحی منطقه کار کرده است. دکتر وال ریون بیش از 120 مقاله در مجلات معتبر بین المللی چاپ کرده است. او همچنین نویسنده کتاب صحت و فقر، مشکلات و راه حل‌های بهداشت جهانی است. و جایزه نخست در رده صحت و مراقبت اجتماعی در جوایز کتاب سالانه انجمن پزشکی بریتانیا در سال 2011 را دریافت کرد. لطفاً به دکتر وال ریون خوش آمدید بگویید.
ما در حال گذراندن دوره بی سابقه در تاریخ خود به عنوان یک جماعت جهانی هستیم. بسیاری از ما با ادامه شیوع ویروس کرونا در سراسر جهان راههای برای زندگی کردن در شرایط عادی جدید پیدا کرده ایم. اما ما واقعا خوش شانس هستیم. واقعیت این است که برای بسیاری از افرادی که در مناطق روستایی یا مناطق فقیرنشین در آسیا و آفریقا زندگی می کنند، در جوامع فقیر و در جوامع با زیربناهای صحی ضعیف از اثر کووید 19 خسارات قابل توجه وارد شده است. اکثریت نفوس مردم جهان و جمعیت اسماعیلی برای مقابله با بیماری همگیر کووید 19 یا کرونا با مشکل عظیم روبرو شدند و کمک به این افراد در اولویت اصلی برنامه های شبکه توسعه آقاخان و مؤسسات جماعتی بوده است. کانسل ملی و مؤسسات کیدین برای اطمینان از پاسخگویی گسترده به بیماری همگیر در حال همکاری های هرچی بیشتر هستند. ما با هم تقریبا از 3 میلیون نفر و 600 هزار خانواده در سراسر جهان کمک و پشتیبانی کرده ایم و در حالی که هر بخشی از اکوسیستم ما نقش مهم در مدیریت این بحران دارد، نهادهای صحی ما به خصوص در این زمان حیاتی هستند. در مؤسسه خدمات صحی آقاخان ما به 3 روش اساسی شبکه متشکل از 377 مرکز صحی و 14 شفاخانه را ساخته ایم. اولا ما تلاش های خود را بروی افزایش آگاهی دهی از کووید 19 متمرکز کرده ایم و تاکید بر چگونگی از جلوگیری از آلوده شدن و چگونگی جلوگیری از شیوع بیشتر شدن ویروس کرونا در جوامع خود کردیم. این بدان معناست که در بعضی از کشورها مانند افغانستان و تاجیکستان کارمندان صحی و رضاکاران جماعت ما برای آگاهی دهی خانه به خانه می روند. ثانیاً ما زیربناهای فیزیکی و فنی را برای تامین مشارکت جماعت مانند همکاری بین مؤسسه خدمات صحی آقاخان برای پاکستان و دولت گلگیت بالتستان ایجاد کردیم و به ما امکان باز کردن یک سایت پاسخ ویروس کرونا را داده است که متمرکز بر کووید 19 است. ما همچنین خدمات صحی را از راه دور با مشارکت AKHS و دانشگاه آقاخان راه اندازی کرده ایم تا از راه دور به شکل مجازی معلومات و خدمات صحی را برای جماعت ارائه دهیم. ما همچنان مشاوره رایگان صحی از طریق مجازی نیز در دوشنبه تاجیکستان ارائه می کنیم، زیرا میزان عفونت کارکنان صحی و آمار بلند ویروس کرونا باعث بسته شدن موقتی مراکز صحی گردیده است. ثالثا مرکز منابع دیجیتال شبکه انکشافی آقاخان در کراچی برنامه کنترل ویروس را ساخته است که با کمکان می توان علائم را در خانه شناسایی نمود تا از بیماران و کارکنان مراقبت های صحی حمایت کند و اطمینان حاصل شود که امکانات صحی می تواند روی بیمارانی که نیاز به مراقبت های پیشرفته دارند تمرکز کنند. علاوه بر این، تلاش های شبکه انکشافی آقاخان و سایر مؤسسات آن نقش اساسی در مبارزه با کووید 19 را دارند. من می خواهم به کار مهمی که کانسل ملی با حمایت دفتر فوکس برای ارائه کمک های عاجل بشر دوستانه به ویژه غذا، دوا و سرپناه به کسانی که از عواقب شدید اقتصادی این بیماری همگیر رنج می برند اشاره کنم. در حالی که مؤسسات ما به شکل خستگی ناپذیر برای تامین نیازهای جماعت تلاش کرده است، دو قهرمان در این مبارزه اعضای جماعت از جمله رضاکاران کانسل ملی و همچنان کارمندان ایکیدین رضاکارانی هستند که خود را در خط اول این بحران قرار دادند. دکتران، نرس ها و متخصصان صحی کسانی هستند که مدیریت این بیماری همگیر را بر دوش خود گرفتند. ما این قهرمانان را به خاطر تلاش های قابل توجه و مثمر آنها تحسین می کنیم، زیرا بعضی از کشورهای قرنطینه شدند و بعضی دیگر تازه قرنطین را شروع می کنند. من فقط یک پیام ساده برای جماعت دارم. لطفاً فاصله اجتماعی را مراعت نموده و تا حد امکان از فعالیت‌های اجتماعی جلوگیری نمایید و برای فعالیت‌های اجتماعی از خانه بیرون نروید. چند هفته گذشته کار ساده‌ای نبود، زیرا مجبور شدیم خود را در خانه قرنطین کنیم. جدا بودن از نظر فیزیکی از دوستان و خانواده کار دشوار است، اما همچنین بهترین کار است که می توانید برای محافظت از عزیزان خود انجام دهید. شکریه، شکر، دنیوات، آسانتا سانا، تشکر، سپاسیبا، مرسی، اوبریگادو.
Well, thank you for joining us today, Dr. Heiss Walraven. It's nice to speak to you again after many years. It's been a pleasure working with you in the past, and I'm happy to speak to you today. And today, you know, I really wanted to take the opportunity to ask you, how is this pandemic affecting some of the populations in which Aga Khan Health Services is working and the broader network is working?
AKHS has been and continues to work in a number of countries in Central Asia, South Asia, the Middle East and East Africa. And we work in many circumstances really with relatively remote, vulnerable populations. And we saw this happening. We saw what was happening in Wuhan, then Italy, then other countries in Europe, in North America, the US, Canada. When it comes to our health systems, we had to adapt them, and we learned a lot. We learned a lot from our colleagues in the North or in the West, including the Ismaili health professionals in Canada, who we engaged, as well as from other countries. And they were learning, they were seeing, and were really experiencing what was happening in their own countries. However, you need to realize that the health systems are very different from the Canadian situation, and you know this. When it comes to that, we really had to prepare and, for instance, get in place protocols, but also to ramp up our capacity to deal with severe and critical patients. We have always had a focus on community health, primary health care, and increasingly over the last decade also secondary and tertiary health care. But in a number of circumstances, especially in the rural areas, those rural hospitals really did not have much capacity if it comes to dealing with severe and critical patients. And we had to put that in place. So if it comes to the ventilators, if it comes to the oxygen, if it comes to treatment like dexamethasone, again, learning from elsewhere, we were able to adapt and adjust. Similarly with testing, in many of the areas and circumstances and places where we worked, we didn't have that testing capacity, especially if it comes to the gold standard RT-PCR, as it is called. And we're putting that in place. And obviously, like I think the whole world, we were not prepared for the scale of what was coming towards us. But I think now, obviously, we're not there yet, but we are in a much better position than we were, let's say, 9 months ago.
You spoke of, you know, some of the different challenges that you have in contexts that are outside of the North American or Western Europe settings. Could you elaborate on maybe some of the specific challenges that, you know, AKHS has had in approaching this virus?
When it comes to supplies, equipment, personal protective equipment, including so the gloves and the masks, etc., we were scrambling in the beginning. As you know, everybody tried to purchase this, and in a way that was not easy in the context that also high-income countries, the wealthy, in a way, countries, were trying to purchase this as well. And prices went up and there were shortages. And to overcome that, we had to do a lot of work to ramp up and get ready. We were greatly supported by something which has been existing within the Aga Khan Development Network for a longer period of time. We have a specific mechanism to do what we call group purchasing, as well as the global networks which we have, helped us to overcome some of those challenges. When it comes to marginalized populations, indeed, you can imagine that this goes back to the promotion and the prevention. It is very easy for us in the North or in the West to think about avoiding crowding. But if you're working and living, let's say, in poorer socioeconomic situations in a Mumbai, in a Karachi, in a Dushanbe, in a Dar es Salaam, those kind of things are much more difficult to overcome and to think about. And especially in the West and also in Canada, you have social networks, social protection mechanisms. And social protection mechanisms in many of the circumstances where we work are not available. So if you think about being a daily wager and having to go out to make your daily living, and at the same time to think about protecting yourself and prevent that you become infected, those kind of things are extremely difficult to realize.
How is AKHS planning for the release of vaccines to countries in which Aga Khan Health Services operates? And how will that be rolled out? Or when do you foresee that being rolled out?
Shafiqa, if I might want to make one step backwards, and that goes about the response which AKDN has had around the pandemic. And it really was based on four pillars. Pillar one was related to health promotion, disease prevention. The second one was the sort of health response, or the medical response, making sure that the staff was trained, that we had the PPEs, that we had the equipment and the supplies. Number three was really supporting the Jamaat if there were issues around what you could call humanitarian aid, if ensuring that they had food, that they had medicines if they had to purchase them. So if they had to pay the rent and couldn't afford it. So really supporting the Jamaat to get through the crisis. And then the fourth pillar, and that is going forward extremely important as well, is the general development issues. So how do we address education? How do we address continuing livelihood? So in a way, something which is completely normal in, let's say, Canada, if it comes to social protection mechanisms, that somehow we try to help in that regard as well, the populations which we serve. I think if you don't do that, then you really are putting people in a very difficult position, because it's so difficult then to deal with the pandemic if you don't address the wider agenda. To come back to the vaccine question, vaccines are becoming available, but vaccines are becoming available at the moment only in the high-income countries. Again, Europe, North America, including Canada. And before we started the interview, Shafiqa, you told me that you're going to vaccinate after this interview the members of your elderly home, which obviously is very great to hear. When it comes to the low and middle income countries, unfortunately, we are a bit behind. There are only a limited number of vaccines available at this moment in time, and they are not ending up, as we see it, in the countries in which we work. They might become available, but it will be later on. And what is very important is that we all think about and try to see how we can support equity in vaccine distribution. Unfortunately, we are seeing something which you could call vaccine nationalism. That, and it's understandable. Populations are worried and politicians react to that worry and want to help their own populations to get access to vaccines. But what we really need is that priority groups are served in an equitable manner all over the globe. So that means indeed the frontline workers, including the healthcare workers, but also others who are doing really the frontline work in response to the pandemic. It means the elderly, it means those with underlying conditions, so that they are becoming better protected, which helps us a lot to avoid also the overcrowding in our health systems. And the health systems are vulnerable, as we see in high-income countries, but they're much more vulnerable in the low- and middle-income countries, including the countries in which AKDN works. So that's really something which is extremely important, that we get equitable access to vaccines around the globe. Canada is supporting the mechanism which is called COVAX. And COVAX is a mechanism which has been put in place by the United Nations and includes, for instance, the World Health Organization, but also the global body which looks after vaccination, the normal routine vaccination against measles, name it. And that is an entity called Gavi. That entity has been established with the support of the United Nations, of a number of countries, by foundations like the Gates Foundation. And that mechanism tries to ensure that by the end of 2021, 20% of the global population, which are the high-risk groups, is going to be vaccinated. And that has also been signed up in that agreement around COVAX by the 92 low and middle income countries. And that includes all the countries in which AKDN works as well. We are trying to align with that. And that is a major emphasis of what we try to do.
And Heis, you know, you spoke about so many things in that last response. There is kind of a global brothership or required or partnership required with COVAX to ensure that there's equitable distribution of the vaccine across the world. We are privileged in Canada to have had that opportunity at our site specifically already. You mentioned in your last response that, you know, the healthcare systems are overwhelmed. We see that to some extent in Canada. And you mentioned how that's exaggerated or even a bigger challenge in middle and low income countries. How can we as the Canadian Jamaat better support the work that Aga Khan Health Services is doing in many of these middle to low income countries? And how can we support currently during the pandemic in its active phase as we move through various waves? And even after we move through these waves?
I think what is very important is that if you are called to be vaccinated, that you go for it. The vaccines which have been approved in Canada are safe and efficacious. So when you're called up to be vaccinated, it's extremely important that you go for it. We need to all be vaccinated, or at least a large proportion of the population needs to be vaccinated to get rid of this pandemic. That's the bottom line. When it comes to how the Jamaat could help us, the Canadian Jamaat, there have been already some great initiatives. We have had great support from the health professionals all over the world, including from Canada, who have been advising and helping us. And also, really, if it comes to individual hospitals, they have had great support in, for instance, being able to discuss cases in our hospitals and getting input from those Canadian health professionals how to deal with certain situations in relation to severe and critical care for COVID patients. That engagement goes further. We are getting a great support and have established at the global level experts related to, for instance, testing, related to vaccines, related to therapeutics. And those global bodies are advising us and helping us to come up with the right solutions for the Jamaat in the countries in which AKDN works, so the lower middle income countries. One other thing is we have had great support if it comes to moving the whole agenda and responding to the pandemic from the Jamaat via what is called the Pandemic Fund. And that really has helped us over the last almost year now to respond and getting the financial means as well to do the right thing. And we will need more of that going forward, also as we start working on the vaccines. When it comes to the vaccines, we are developing vaccination implementation plans for each of the geographies in which we work. And there is a major difference when it comes to this vaccine. We are used to vaccinating, let's say, children or vaccinating pregnant mothers. Now we need to think about vaccinating priority groups which are very different. So we need to adapt the way how we vaccinate and how we go around it in the geographies in which we work. Developing these vaccination implementation plans helps us also to engage with the government. It is the governments who are deciding which vaccines they authorize and which they allow to get into those countries, in their own countries. They're in control. We're trying to help governments to preparing and go and ensuring that the vaccination can happen and that as many people participate in those vaccinations to overcome indeed also something which is common all over the world, which needs to be addressed around vaccine hesitancy. So people who are really a bit reluctant to go for the vaccination. And it's understandable. It's a new thing. However, I can assure you that the vaccines which are being authorized and which are coming through at the moment are safe and efficacious. And if we want to overcome the pandemic, and it doesn't know borders, so if we want to overcome it at the global scale, we really need to help each other. So I end where I started in my response on the vaccines. If you have a chance to be vaccinated and you're called to be vaccinated, go for it.
You're right about that hesitancy, and we really do need to kind of take that approach of this is the only way that we will kind of be rid of this pandemic or move past this pandemic. Heis, I just want to elaborate on one point that you mentioned. You know, the Adcon Health Services has quite the reputation for excellent vaccine rollouts in countries when it was, you know, dealing with either whether it was polio or diphtheria, any of those routine vaccines. I know firsthand with working with the program in Tajikistan that there was a huge absorbency when Aga Khan Health Services, you know, promoted it and applied, you know, a strategic approach to ensuring that all children got the vaccines at the appropriate age. If they had been missed, there was mechanisms for them to go back and get those vaccines. So I have no doubt that, you know, with the rollout of the COVID vaccine, Aga Khan Health Services has the experience and the wealth of knowledge to, you know, help countries execute this appropriately once they've been approved or accessed by those countries.
Just to add to what you're saying, Shafika, on an annual basis, AKHS gives around almost 2 million vaccinations per year. In our early estimation, to address the issue in the priority groups in our core geographies, we probably need slightly more than 6 million vaccinations to be done. So it's also something for us clearly to think about. I think indeed you're correct in saying that we have a lot of experience in vaccinations, but we also will need to scale up. And that process of thinking that through and engaging the authorities and our partners at this moment in time is extremely important.
Yes.
The Pfizer vaccine needs what is called a deep cold chain. So you really need to keep it extremely cold. You're talking about freezers of -70 degrees Celsius. You can imagine that if it comes to the circumstances wherein AKHS functions, that almost always will not be feasible. So we will need vaccines which can be kept in a normal fridge, which already limits the number of vaccines which are available for low and middle income countries and needs to be thought through. The other thing which is important is most of the vaccines under development, you need two doses. And it really would be so helpful for the circumstances in which we work that we could do it with one dose. What we also need to realize if it comes to vaccines, that vaccines might not sound to be that expensive if it comes to Canada or high-income countries. But a vaccine that costs $10 per person for some of the countries and situations in which we work is more than the expenditure per capita per year in health. And that's something which also needs to be addressed.
You make an excellent point in both the availability, the ease of use of vaccines, and the cost per capita for these vaccines. All inhibit extra challenges in rolling out this vaccine in some of the countries in which Aga Khan Health Services works. You know, when we did vaccinate generations, we had several nurses come in with large freezer bags. Temperature controls are monitored, you know, every 15 minutes. We have light shields to keep the vaccine safe. It is administered in small quantities to the residents so that we're not wasting vaccine. All those logistical challenges are amplified in some of the countries because there is a lack of, as you mentioned, sometimes infrastructure to support that.
Perhaps one last point, and that's related again to vaccines and specifically Canada. Canada has pre-purchased per capita more vaccines than any other country in the world. And it is quite likely, it is almost certain, that it will have too many vaccines. I really hope that we can advocate for Canada to gift those vaccines via the COVAX mechanism, and that some of those supplies then also end up in the countries and in the geographies where the Jamaat and its neighbors are living.
Heis, can you tell us about perhaps the most difficult moment in this crisis for you or for Aga Khan Health Services?
Safika, the most difficult moment, I think, for myself as well as for our team was the first hospital which was really saw in search of cases was the Aga Khan Hospital in Dar es Salaam. And it really, the numbers really increased very rapidly. People came very late to the hospital, died in accident in emergency or shortly after arrival. So they came very late, and we had to do a lot of work about reinforcing both with health professionals, primary care physicians, nurses, as well as the general audience to come earlier. But we were really struggling, and the most difficult moment for me was when we had the first staff member, the head of our outreach health facilities in Tanzania, a young man, 42 years old, with a family, dying himself of COVID in our hospital, and the distraught of the staff, and then how to deal with that and to encourage the team and the staff of the Aga Khan Hospital to cope with that really was quite something, and we all felt personally affected by it. Obviously, that was very tragic, but I also think we came stronger out of it. I think the Aga Khan Hospital, Dar es Salaam, has been helping us then to move forward in the protocols, in their experiences. And we had a lot of support, again, from the health professionals in dealing with this first wave in one of our facilities, from other parts in the world, and including from Canada.
I'm sure there have been other moments of pride and moments of accomplishment within the last, you know, year, 8 months. How could you share one of those moments?
I want to give you one example. This is indeed, I would say, quite exciting. I'm talking now about Buni in northern Pakistan, high mountainous area, difficult to reach. A bit comparable to, let's say, Gorna Balakshan in Tajikistan.
Yes.
We had a program which was indeed with a strong base in community health and primary health care. Over the last 10 to 20 years, we have been establishing secondary health care in the small town of Buni, which is the capital of what is called Upper Chitral, with a large Jamaati population. We did not have the capacity to deal with severe or critical cases there. However, we started preparing for that in April, and by July we had, you could say, a good deal in place. We were able to get in to ensure that we had the ventilators, to ensure that we had the treatment protocols, that we had the oxygen supplies, that we also had special wards for moderate patients, especially moderate patients with underlying conditions, so that if something would happen and they would become more severe, that they could be transferred easily to the unit which can deal with more severe cases. We got admitted in Buni Health Center, who was truly 103 years old, a carpenter. And that 103-year-old man was able to survive. He had moderate COVID. It took him almost 10 days to recover and to be discharged. He made it in the New York Times. And that was something we were all extremely proud of.
And certainly a moment to be extremely proud of your team and all of the accomplishments of Aga Khan Health Services.
We are in this. And I've said this before. It started as a sprint, but it has become a marathon with the speed of a sprint. And we still have a difficult period to come over. It's not going to finish this pandemic in the coming weeks. It will take time, and we need to get through this all together. And I think we can do it all together. We will do it all together. But it also has learned me that if it comes to our work and how we have done, I'm really proud of our teams and how we have reacted as AKDN, as a Jamaati leadership. And you can see that back in the data which we have, is that when it comes to the Jamaat, if it comes to the number of infections, if it comes to mortality rates, that we're doing pretty well compared to other similar circumstances in our different geographies. So, yeah, there's more work to be done and there will be difficulties, but we're going to overcome this.
For sure. And it started in a sprint and it's a marathon that the Aghan Health Service is conquering and still running and will continue to run, I'm sure, until it reaches the finish line. And hopefully we as a Canadian Jamaat will be cheering and pushing along as needed and supporting wherever we can in that endeavor.
And perhaps one last point, and it was His Highness who helped us here, as he always helps us. But in this case, we were thinking about a COVID-19 fund and response. His Highness said we need a pandemic response. And he's completely correct. And what I think all one of the other advantages is of what has happened over the last almost now 1 year is that we obviously are dealing with COVID-19, but we will be much better prepared for future other pandemics as well, which will eventually also come. We can't deny it anymore.
Heist, you know, we've seen throughout the pandemic that there's been a differing level of morbidity or mortality, or some would even say suffering, in the Western world compared, or in high-income countries compared to those middle and low-income countries. Have you come to thoughts on why that may be? And is that still the case? Globally, do we have a better understanding of why that may be occurring?
That's not an easy question to answer. First of all, many of the low and middle income countries have a younger population, so the demographics is different. Another factor could be that those who are there have less underlying conditions, especially the non-communicable diseases. They might also be more used to having communicable diseases and with that have, in a way, a good developed immune response. In a number of circumstances where AKDN works, we work, for instance, in Central Asia, mainly in high mountainous rural populations. And crowding there is less of an issue than, let's say, in the slums of Mumbai or the crowded areas in, let's say, Kabul or other big cities. But in addition, there has also been certainly a theory, and it is difficult to prove, but the idea that living in high mountainous areas might be protective because populations who live in high mountainous areas are used to lower oxygen levels and their physiology, their body, including the production of what is called hemoglobin, and this is perhaps a bit too technical, but the physiology and the way how the body reacts has been adapted to circumstances that you might have lower oxygen levels, which is a major problem with COVID-19, and perhaps that could help them also then to survive. The last one, obviously, which is becoming more and more clear as well over the last number of weeks, is air pollution. In the high mountainous areas of Central Asia, Shafika, as you know, air pollution is not a real problem, but it is a major problem in, let's say, Delhi or Mumbai. So there you see indeed that air pollution we know now contributes to certainly more severe disease related to COVID as well. And perhaps one additional point, Shafika, and that is low and middle income countries, especially those in sub-Saharan Africa and in Asia, they are used to communicable diseases, they're used to outbreaks. So they're also more used to respond to that, I would suggest. Well, we in the North or the West might have forgotten that. So that is certainly also another factor which is important that we need to take into consideration.
I think that's an extremely important factor and something I think even I didn't think of, and I'm sure many of us around here didn't think of, you know, or take for granted on a daily basis. But things that have certainly been brought to light because of the pandemic.
Thank you, Safika. I enjoyed this.
As did I, Heis. It's been a pleasure speaking to you again. I can say I tremendously miss the team, and it's been an honor to be able to speak to you today.
دکتر والریون، سپاسگزارم که با ما پیوستید. ما کار شما را تشویق میکنیم و به همه شما فکر میکنیم، زیرا بنیاد انکشافی آقاخان با آوردن واکسن به سایر نقاط دنیا کمک میکند. و در مورد حمایت از جماعت جهانی، ما اکنون نگاهی به کارهایی که توسط برخی از متخصصان بهداشت و درمان در سراسر جهان برای ارائه وقت، مهارت و دانش خود انجام دادن می اندازیم. امیدوارم از آن لذت ببرید.
During my golden jubilee, smileys from around the world volunteered their gifts, not only of wealth, but most notably of time and knowledge in support of our work. We established a time and knowledge framework, a structured process for engaging an immense pool of expertise involving tens of thousands of volunteers. Many of them traveled to the developing countries as part of this outpouring of service. Their impact has been enormous in helping us to achieve best practice standards in our institutions and programs.
We created healthy food and meals and eliminated use of sodium, sugar levels, and fat content in meals throughout the campus.
The monies that we saved from efficiency and purchasing better and in utilizing ingredients much, much better, that money can go to patient welfare. So it would help patients who would otherwise not be able to afford the care, but in this way we can now support more patients than we were able to do previously.
I felt that coconut water was better. Kenya had no recycling program, so we did not know where to put these plastic bottles. And the coconut water had nutritional benefits. It also helped with the local economy. I went to a street in Mombasa and got a coconut seller to come to the school with hundreds of coconuts. That improved his lot in life.
Tajikistan has also adopted a new profession called a family nurse. So in many of the rural areas, they don't actually have a doctor, but they have a trained nurse who understands many of the concepts of family medicine and some of the common illnesses that come. And they actually deal with patients. And only when they think they can't deal with something, they send them on to the next larger town or city to get treated there. When the family medicine program was started, there was a full renovation done for all these facilities. New equipment was bought, new supplies were brought in. Physicians and nurses were retrained as family doctors and family nurses for 6 months, usually in Dushanbe, in the capital city, and then brought back. A complete new medical record system was established, and then the patients started being seen. What I get out of this is simply the fact that when I look around the clinics and I see the enthusiasm, the positivity among the doctors, how excited they are that they are now doing a good job, a better job. Some of the younger doctors I've asked, and they say that we feel excited that we're able to see people of all ages, and that gives us variety in our care. Some of the older doctors, I distinctly remember one doctor who said to me, "Listen, I only looked after women, and I'm not going to change, so don't even try." And that doctor today now sees men, and she has started seeing children. So that's exciting, that's good to know. On the other side, when you look at the community, it feels good to see that people have the confidence and they go to these family medicine centers.
What do I get out of it? You know, that's a tricky question. But you know, it gives me that upliftment, right? It gives me that satisfaction. Yes, I did something. Whether, you know, if I train somebody, it's not that just that person who is going to be capable. It's me too, that I have given my knowledge to somebody. I was in a position to give it and I gave it. So that's what I'm getting from it. And not only that, but it's also that now I've done my service to the Imam. If I have my strength in my area, I have weaknesses in other areas, like local language, local culture. So you have to be willing to accept that as well and to take that with you as well, and to take the friendship that you have created.
تبریک به تمام متخصصین بخش صحی که در سطح منطقوی یا جهان خدمت کردند و از برادران و خواهران ما در محلات و جاهای دیگر حمایت نمودند. من این فرصت را داشتم. می دانم که این هم یک عمل خدمت است و هم در زمینه رشد خودی و روشنگری فردی نقش بسزای بازی می کند. همانطور که حاضر مامان را بیان کرده است. و حالا ما اولین بخش از مجموعه مکالمات کووید را داریم که در آن با سوالات پرداخته می شود که توسط اعضای جماعت در مورد بیماری کووید یا واکسین مطرح شده است. همانطور که همه ما می دانیم، ویروس کووید همچنان در سراسر جهان در اوج خود قرار دارد و بسیاری از مکانها برای بار دوم یا سوم به صورت کامل مسدود گردیدند. بسیار مهم است که ما در امان باشیم. از آمیختن با دیگران در خارج از خانه تان اجتناب کنید و با افراد خارج از منزل از طریق تلفن یا زوم مکالمه کنید. تا آنجا که ممکن است در خانه بمانید و همیشه ماسک خود را در موقع بیرون رفتن بپوشید. ما به یک سالگی این بیماری همگیر نزدیک می شویم و پایان راه نزدیک است. یکی از پرسش هایی که بار بار مطرح می شود در مورد ایمنی واکسین هاست. میلیون ها نفر در سراسر جهان در حال حاضر این واکسین را دریافت کرده اند بدون عوارض جدی جانبی. بیایید نگاهی به این ویدیو از دولت کانادا بیندازیم تا بفهمیم که چگونه این واکسین ها با معیارهای ایمنی بالا در مدت زمان کوتاهی تولید شده اند.
Vaccines are the most effective way to prevent the spread of infectious disease, but developing one can be costly, long, and complex. However, with significant investment and collaboration at a global scale, developing a vaccine is possible in a much shorter period of time. So how are vaccines developed today? And will the development of a COVID-19 vaccine be different? All vaccines go through three basic stages of development: the exploratory stage, the preclinical stage, and the clinical stage. In the exploratory stage, scientists do basic laboratory research to find vaccines that can help us develop immunity to a disease before being exposed to it. On January 11, 2020, the genetic code of the virus causing COVID-19 was published. This allowed scientists all over the world to start working on finding potential vaccines. With more than 150 in development worldwide, scientists are using current approaches like using whole or parts of killed or weakened virus, and newer techniques such as delivering COVID genetic material directly into cells. In the preclinical stage, scientists use laboratory and animal studies to identify safety concerns before testing the vaccine in humans. It is also used to help find the safest dose. While many vaccine candidates don't progress beyond this point, successful ones move on to the clinical stage, where they are first tested in humans. This stage normally consists of three phases. Phase 1 trials involve a small number of healthy volunteers to test safety and confirm that the vaccine causes an immune response. An immune response refers to how our body recognizes and defends itself from viruses and other potentially harmful substances. Promising vaccines then progress to Phase 2, where they're given to hundreds of participants, including groups at risk of the disease. The goal of Phase 2 is to test the vaccine's safety, the proposed doses and method of delivery, and again, to assess the immune response. Phase 3 studies involve thousands of volunteer participants and compare groups that received the vaccine to those that didn't. These studies are used to further answer whether the vaccine works and still demonstrate that it's safe for use. One way scientists have worked to reduce the time to develop a COVID vaccine has been to use study designs that allow merging of clinical phases. For example, new approaches have allowed for Phase 2 participants to be included in larger Phase 3 studies, allowing scientists to shorten the overall timeline and number of participants needed, without cutting corners or compromising safety. The first COVID-19 vaccine trials in humans started in March of 2020. Since then, tens of thousands of volunteers have been enrolled in clinical studies worldwide. Health Canada, responsible for regulating the use of vaccines in Canada, has authorized clinical trials for COVID-19 vaccines. Before approving a new vaccine, they look closely at all the data on it, paying very close attention to its safety. Many vaccines will fail somewhere along this path if they don't work or are unsafe. It's normal, and this is the purpose of all the stages of development and clinical trials. Only those that are proven safe, effective, and of high quality will be approved for use in Canada. A safe and effective vaccine will bring us one step closer to the widespread and long-term management of COVID-19. Visit canada.ca/coronavirus to learn more.
بابت این کار ممنونم. بیایید که هدایت مولانا حاضر امام را به یاد بیاوریم. دوست دارم که جماعت من با توصیه ها و دستورات مسئولین صحی آنان هدایت شود تا از مسئولیت این واکسین ها بهره مند گردد. و حالا می خواهم حامد غفرانی را معرفی کنم که با ما در مورد یک برنامه هیجان انگیز به نام ادیسا صحبت خواهد کرد. ادیسا یک اردوگاه یا کمپ مجازی برای دانش آموزان سنین 14 تا 17 است که در طول دو آخر هفته در ماه مارچ برگزار خواهد شد. لطفاً به حامد خوش آمدید بگویید.
جماعت محترم عزیز، سلام یا علی مدد. امیدوارم که هر کجا که هستید خوب و خوش و سلامت و تندرست باشید. خدمت شما رسیدم که آغاز ثبت نام برای یک برنامه آموزشی بسیار جالب و غنی برای جوانان جماعت را خدمت شما خبررسانی کنم. کمپ اودیسه یا اودیسی یک کمپ آموزشی آنلاین برای جوانان 14 تا 17 ساله است. تمامی مؤسسات از جمله طریق بورد، ایژوکیشن بورد، بورد جوانان و ورزش دور هم جمع شدند و دست به دست هم دادند و یک برنامه همه جانبه و کلی و بسیار جامع رو برای این جوانان طراحی و تهیه کردم. فرصتی استثنایی است برای این جوانان که با همسالان و همیالان خودشون از سراسر کانادا آشنا بشوند، دوستان جدید بیابند و کسانی که با آنها علاقه مشترک دارند کارهای گروهی انجام بدن و از همه مهمتر احساس تعلق به جامعه اسماعیلی کانادا با تمام تنوع و تکثرش رو احساس کنند. یک جوان که در این برنامه شرکت می کند، در این برنامه کمپ آدسی، فرصتی خواهد داشت که درباره سوالات بسیار مهم که در این مقطع از زندگی باید جوانان بپرسند، تفکر و با دیگران تبادل نظر کند. سوالاتی از جمله این که داستان من چیست؟ من به عنوان یک جوان اسماعیلی کانادایی چه تجربه هایی دارم؟ اینکه دنیای قرن 21 چه فرصت‌ها و چه چالش‌هایی را برای من در چنته دارد. اینکه اهداف و آرزوها و آمال من کدامند و چگونه می‌توانم برای رسیدن به این اهداف برنامه‌ریزی بکنم. این برنامه به زبان انگلیسی و در دو آخر هفته ماه مارچ، ششم و هفتم مارچ و سیزدهم و چهاردهم مارچ که هر دو شنبه و یک شنبه ان انشاءالله برگزار خواهد شد و امیدوارم که همانطور که ما به موفقیت و یادگیری این برنامه اطمینان کامل داریم، خانواده ها و جوان های ما هم از این فرصت استثنایی نهایت استفاده رو بکنن و اون رو غنیمت بشمارن. و قبل از این که مهلت ثبت نام تمام بشه که تاریخ 31 ژانویه آخرین مهلت ثبت نام هست، در این برنامه ثبت نام کنن تا ما اطمینان حاصل کنیم که جماعت ما در کبک هم از این برنامه استفاده خواهد کرد. لینک این برنامه روی صفحه هست و جماعت عزیز اگر سوالات بیشتری راجع به برنامه دارن میتونن با همکاران ما در طریق بورد، در کنسول، در و معلمان استپ تماس بگیرن و به سوالاتشون جواب داده خواهد شد. با امید سلامت و سعادت برای همگی، یا علی مدد و شبتون خوش.
از شما بسیار سپاسگزارم حامد. چنین به نظر می رسد که برنامه بسیار جالب خواهد بود. ما برنامه امشب خود را مثل همیشه با پارچه های موسیقی بسیار دلنگیز خود به پایان می رسانیم. ممنون از این که امروز در اینجا با من هستید و برای شما بهترین ها را برای سال 2021 آرزو می کنم. سپاسگزارم که تماشا کردید و یا علی مدد.
نسل در نسل قیامت بی کپت کرا شیرونو کو تنو منکو شما سم جمعی کر ایک بار دادت تو خوشانی بجے حساب صفو تاہر الفاظ محبت چی گیار مدینار جنو یار دنیا چوبا سو جم دسوں بوئی جمی کو دنیا چوبا سو
سبب مجھے حسین دنیا